collect more money. You're discouraging huge taxpayers from registering for tax.
So in other words, we are not widening the tax base. There's also been a discussion around widening or deepening.
Yes, widening and deepening. Yet the spirit of the domestic resource mobilization strategy was to widen the tax base. How do we bring more Ugandans on board? Of course, we collect more inherent taxes, but you know they have challenges.
Mm.
For example, the introduction of the OTT. Do you know the spirit as to why government decided to introduce OTT over the top tax?
Well, there are a lot of Ugandans on the internet.
Come again?
I want to think it's because there are a lot of Ugandans on the internet.
Not really. That wasn't the reason. So are telecom companies holding them accountable to tax? It was a bit of a challenge. Because we don't have strong systems to audit and, you know, ensure compliance. So they'll disclose. It's up to their mercy. So you don't have these good systems. So the best way was to introduce direct taxes.
And that's on the user, the consumer.
On the consumer. So that's when we came up with OTT on internet over the top, then mobile money tax on mobile money transactions. Because those are direct taxes and they are easy to collect. Then indirect taxes, that means they are more difficult to collect. So in our current context, we are going back to indirect taxes for the context of mobile money. But then for these other direct taxes, we are not providing incentives to ensure that over the 80% Ugandans that are a bit taxable can start paying taxes. You realize the dilemma we are in. So it's a huge discussion. And for us in our context, I think among the win-win situations we have looked out for are the widening of definitions on the beneficial ownership. Because, you know, we've been seeing statistics where, I think in the year 2019, according to some of the reports, we lost about $1 billion in illicit financial flows.
Mm.
In illicit financial flows, there is tax evasions, there is
smuggling,
yes. There are those people that create havens somewhere out there. All those illicit transactions. So they amounted to about $1 billion. But then between 2006 to 2015, we lost about $6 billion. For a country like Uganda, that's a huge amount of money. Then when you look at the money we normally lose through those tax evasions and avoidances, it's about the budget of the agriculture sector. That's about $800 billion. So you imagine what that money would do if we are able to clean up our tax mess. So definitions of beneficial ownership, we think those are some of the best game changers. And now that we are going into the discussions of oil and gas, you know, we've now signed the investment.
FID.
Yeah, the FID. And there's going to be a lot of investment in that sector, but also in other sectors. And, you know, we are opening up a lot. We are trying to provide incentives to investors, $50 million, to get some of these incentives. So a country would want to know who are these investors we are calling on board, you know. Instead of, you know, we've had scenarios where people set up here, but then they are registered in other countries. So we have a problem of tracking them down for tax purposes. And then we go back to the $1 billion loss. So it's a discussion. We think it's a win-win for us. Then there's also a provision for automatic exchange of information. You know, governments are obliged to comply if you are sent to some of these frameworks. So Uganda is among those. And you know, there are also now more provisions on how it will work for tax purposes. So that if I request or if I require some information on a certain company registered, let's say in Argentina, and is trying to set up here, I can automatically get information from Argentina. And the same case will happen for companies that are setting up here. So it will give us also more disclosure and access to some of this information for mainly tax purposes. And this is mainly under the income tax, of course. Then when we go to excise duty, of course, there are also things that come in from that, and we think they are a bit interesting, and that's where we have our 12% on internet.
Yeah.
It's been causing a lot of public uproar, I know. Because if you look at we are in the 21st century, right?
Mm-hmm.
And we are still taxing internet.
At a time where we've tested the necessity of e-commerce.
Exactly. So that's like, biting the hand that's feeding you. One, it kills innovation. Then many businesses are also going to die. If you look at, the sizable businesses that were trying to mushroom. Then also, schools are changing. Many people are now going digital.
Mm-hmm.
Instead of using fuel every day to go to a certain institution to learn, I'd rather use the comfort of my laptop.
I sit down, exactly. Load data bundles
and
attend class.
But if you look at our current cost of data, actually even around the East African region, we are among the highest.
Absolutely.
And Tanzania, for them, they are reviewing all their data tariffs. And now Uganda, we are trying to increase, even at a time when we are already high. And that's a bit sorry for Ugandans, because most of us now prefer, if it's private data at home, we prefer using Freaky Fridays because they are more affordable. So without the Freaky Fridays, that means from Monday to Thursday, there is no much business going on. So we think it's a huge blow. And when you try to go for these petty direct taxes and you ignore the end benefits, you tend to lose out. Instead of taxing internet, for us, we think government should let internet be cheap and then start taxing the online,
Because that way merchants. It will attract a lot of users.
It will users, but also a lot of investment in digital platforms. Because within the past, I think, 4 years, we've seen Uber, we've seen TaxFi, we've seen Safe Border, we've seen Jumia, we've seen, yes.
On the internet.
Mm. Yeah, now if you're operating a restaurant and you're not online, they regard you as a non-serious person. But the more you tax it, of course, people would rather go back to the analog. And I think one of our ministers saying we can go without internet. That was too annoying.
Taking us back to the stone age.
Did you see the general? He's actually general who was saying we can go without internet. I think that's, in the current era, some things are not.
That's no option. Mm.
No, it's not an option. Yeah.
Absolutely. What around, before we move on to another, what other proposals around the excise duty that you think would be the ideal among the proposals civil society is bringing forward?
There have been lots of proposals, but I think in the current context, you'd put the proposals aside and address some of the administrative issues. Because like I was giving you an example of the illicit financial flows. Some of them are administrative. If you look at issues of compliance, some of them are administrative. If you look at issues of widening the tax base, perhaps some of them are administrative. For example, if you go to a district like Kayumbe, how many tax offices do you have there?
It goes back to
so many
administrative factor of power.
There are so many tax potentials there. If you look at the borders, most of our borders are still porous.
Mm-hmm.
So how many goods are smuggled in, day out?
Without anyone watching.
Yeah, we have gold that comes into Uganda, right? But we don't know the source. We know Uganda earns a lot from gold, imports and exports, but we don't, some of those things are administrative.
Absolutely.
And we think if we can close on some of these administrative gaps, of course, the manpower, but also the technical expertise, then maybe the law can catch up later. And in the current context of COVID, we'd want to see more stimulus packages. And then through that, we want to see more money, flowing within the economy.
Let's talk about the income tax, particularly the rental income tax. Having full disclosure of all property and the money being levied separately, not at a go as it has been.
Yeah, still, like I was saying, still, there are issues with administration. when you create a provision, you not declare separately. Of course, that's manpower for the landlord, because you have to start hiring people to do that on a monthly or annual or as you're supposed to. But also, if you go to now URA or the tax collector, you have to start chasing after these landlords to ensure that they respond, to ensure that they comply. So looking at our skeleton staff of the tax collectors, how many properties are you going to register in Buwate, then you go to Uchira, then you go to Nigeria, and that's only around Kampala. But how about other areas? And you know, of course, this is not something for the city alone. It's supposed to operate in the entire country. So is there a workforce that's ready with capacity in some of these upcountry districts to collect this money? Are they are ready to start enforcing and ensuring that landlords comply? So it creates a lot of work, a lot of burden, yet it should have been smarter if someone accounts for them at once. But I think the spirit was that some people offset. So if you're making losses here, you'd rather the losses are shared across board. That's on the side of the landlord. So the spirit of bringing it in this way is, if you look at that 60% cap, they'll say, okay, if you're making these many losses, let the losses be at plot one. Let them not be spread to the other plots, which is also a win-win. But in our context, I think we would rather have this manpower and the technical capacity to let people account as a sum, because it's more like a company. Mm-hmm. If I account for tax as David and I'm running David Properties, then there should be a list of buildings under me, and then let there be one sheet so that even the tax collector is able to trace them through. Because some people may decide to leave out other properties in that process of accounting for a property separately. Maybe I have a property in Kavala and I have a property in Kampala. I will declare a property in Kavala and leave a property in Kampala. Yet if everything is put in a cluster, you're able to track it all at once. Then that other proposal maybe, which would be a win-win for the landlords, is they would have more disposable income. You know, with the context of Ugandans that are creative in accounting, someone will decide to account for the 60% in losses and expenditure, and then, you know, they use all that money to invest it somewhere. But then the other thing that's administrative, I think, in terms of rent and property, realize that the real estate sector is too porous, it's too unregulated, and it becomes a challenge for government. We
so
don't have information
there that you can take advantage of.
Yes, but they need to first organize the sector before they tax it properly. You know, for example, we don't have a comprehensive inventory on the landlords. We don't have a comprehensive rate on rental costs or property costs throughout Kampala. You'll find a property in Tinda at about 1 billion. And then go to the neighborhood within the same neighborhood and it will be at about, let's say, 500. So people will sell as they wish. And you know the rates are currently determined by brokers. But as a country, we don't have our national rates that provide either ceilings or floors, price floors. So it's too unregulated. And you know, taxing an unregulated sector is a challenge. I think they tried it with gamings, but real estate is also a virgin area that needs to be worked on.
Okay.
I know once they align it properly and, you know, set it, I think there are lots of taxes we can collect from there.
Okay.
Especially in the context that many Ugandans are currently looking at investing in
real estate.
Mm. Yeah.
What is the position on the Traffic and Road Safety Act, especially where, let's give an example, the urban setting, where it has moved from a luxury to a necessity for someone to own a vehicle, for personal use or even for business? What does that mean if now they would have to be licensed and levied on this particular ownership?
It's quite funny. You know, sometimes we want to develop, but we are like You know, we make a few steps to the front and make huge steps to the back.
Mm-hmm.
The genesis of, I think, the traffic and road safety started with the field. Actually, that tax was initially proposed, but then it was taken to fuel. So instead of taxing the vehicles, I think as a country we thought it's better to tax fuel.
So initially we've been taxing its bringing,
mm-hmm.
and these other licenses, the motor car and all, and the fuel.
It's been mainly the fuel.
Mainly the fuel. So fuel. What? Let's first understand, according to this proposal, mm-hmm. if it is enacted, what will change? That means I'll have to pay a fee, a particular fee annually,
mm-hmm.
to continue using my car the road.
Yes, and every day that you default, you'll pay a fine. So if you're due to pay on 31st January and you pass the date, that means every day that passes, you'll pay, it's called 10 currency points. So 10 times 20,000, that comes to about 200,000. Per day. So that's how heavy it is. But still, like I was saying before, that tax was initially introduced on fuel because it's easier to collect it from there. But also the tax burden shouldn't be felt that much. You know, it's an introduction of a small amount. But then, even with or without taxes, fuel prices are going high. And in an attempt for government to desperately collect taxes, you know, they look at the figures of the owners of vehicles.
Mm.
So they say, if we can introduce this amount on cars, borders and equipment, maybe we shall collect this amount of money. But you know, they ignore certain basics. One, you know, there are lots of double taxation now in the motor. If you look at the environmental levy, now people pay taxes if you import an older model of a car. Then when you go to fuel, you're paying taxes because our fuel costs are a bit huge. And if you go to the neighboring countries, if someone is bringing a car into Uganda, they'd rather fuel a full tanker and even put extra in the car and then come to Uganda because our costs are a bit high. Then, so the introduction of it's about 200,000 shillings per year, Ugandan shillings, on motor vehicles, and about 50,000 for borders. But the entire cost is going to be, you know, there is a distortion now that's likely to happen. One, if you look at the taxi operators, just an increment of 100 shillings on a liter of fuel, how much does it amount towards the fares of? You know, we've seen an increment of about 5,000 shillings just because someone has increased 100 shillings on, you know, on the fuel. So what's going to happen with this tax on transportation?
Of course, they have to increase because at the end of it, they have to make business sense.
Exactly.
They have to file returns.
Exactly.
So they have to increase the fares.
Yeah, so, and you know, our country is hugely private sector, even the transport sector. So they operate as they wish. If you look at COVID,
government can't regulate.
Mm-hmm. So they, of course, the fares are likely to go high.
For the empty seats.
And yet we are paying for the empty seats. So you know, when you want to stimulate growth, of course, mobility is one of those things you look into. People have to, you know, cheaply move from point A to point Z, either to pick goods or to trade.
The other thing I'm grappling with, especially in this this transport vehicle whole thing, is the fact that government has, I don't want to say deliberately failed, but I mean, they haven't shown input, we haven't seen results in regulating public transport per se.
Yeah.
And that drives questions on who or how they're going to track down this money if the registration itself has failed.
Mm.
We do not know which car is driving on which route, how many are they, and in what intervals, you know? So that's just something I've been asking myself.
We have a problem. You know, once you make one mistake or one wrong, and then instead of rectifying it, you just do another mistake, just like telling a lie. You know, you tell a lie, then you have to tell a lie
another
to cover
lie
up for the lie. So by the time you realize that you have to come out clean, it's already too late. If you look at the transport sector, back in the days, transport was mainly public. And in some organized countries, some aspects of transport are supposed to be public, or at least there should be public control. Because then you have control over the fares, you have control over the quality of vehicles that are on your roads, you have quality over almost everything that goes within the sector. But when you come to a country like us, where we are at the mercy of the private sector, you know, it's too hard for government to regulate. And if you come to this specific tax now, you look at the driving permits. Those were some of the easiest, licenses for every person. And then the national IDs. You know, as much as the process is supposed to be this short, just bring your thumbprints, put them in the machine, show the card, enter into a system, and you're cleared. But then how is it going to operate for cars? Because before you license a car, you have to make sure that it's in sound condition. So what's our capacity to check all these millions of cars running on the streets? And that's not on a basis of, let's say, 5-year term, but on an annual basis. That means every year, almost 4 million cars will have to be inspected. But we come from a background where someone takes about a month to get a national ID, and of course about 2 weeks or more to get a driver's license, something that's supposed to take, let's say, about 1 day or two. So that means we shall go about 3 months or four without having our cars licensed. And what's the implication of that on transport and mobility? Like I said, someone has to move from point A to point Z to ferry goods, operate business, and all this. It's a problem. I don't know whether government has thought about it yet or not, but for us, we foresee it as a major challenge, and that's administrative, of course. Then the compliance rate, one of the issues that will come up, of course, corruption is along the corner. But what happens if I default for 2 months? And of course, the charge surpasses the cost of my car. it's a reality, and we have to think of realities. Because people, it's obvious, you reach a point and you don't have the money yet, so you'd rather do away with the car. We want to stimulate our economy, ensure that we recover from COVID. We want to have a lot of liquidity in the country. And some of the proposals we introduce are supposed to foster business. And the only way to foster business is to ensure that we don't tax like we used to do in the monarchy days, where the king would say, okay, today I want 200,000 from every car. But you look through your subjects, how much can they afford? And if I impose this tax, what is it contributing to the economy? And I think one of the missing links is tax accountability, and also this context of, you know, when your income reduces, you also have to reduce on your expenditure and the quality of the goods you consume. So one is people not seeing value for money from their taxes. If you look at COVID, I know some of us got the COVID portion. But you see, the quality of the food we got doesn't correspond to, you know, the amount of taxes we pay. And some
even
of
the
us,
amount of money government say they spent,
yes,
on that food.
Yeah, but the main issue is some of us were asking, does the government respect its citizens? Because one of the key aspects of respect is the quality of, you know, services government gives to you. If you get so much taxes from me and you're giving me old beans, old food, substandard, that means you don't value my input as a citizen. And that's, you know, that's not good for us. But then in the current context, if you look at our neighbors, the Tanzanians, one, they decided to request for that debt relief. So that instead of paying that servicing their debt during Corona, they'd get that relief and they defer their payment to a future debt. And for us, we are still carrying on with our debt. Then we borrowed more money. I think we know that. And then the money we borrowed didn't directly correspond to responding to the, you know, the pandemic. And as a country, like I was saying, when your income reduces, of course you have to cut on your expenditure. And for our thought was that as we think of domestic resource mobilization, taxation and all this, expenditure is one of the things we thought would be very pertinent. For example, the constructions. Instead of investing a lot of money in constructions, roads and all this, I think this COVID period was the time when we would say maybe let's invest more into agriculture and maybe improve on our
human capital development,
improve on the quality of our products and maybe promote exports. This was the time when we had to have such discussions so that instead of spending on things that are not going to bring back money to the economy, perhaps would invest in areas where I would stimulate development, stimulate production, and of course drive development. And it's a discussion, I don't know whether the government is thinking of it. If you look at the money being given to farmers, a new guy doesn't, those are peanuts, it's like a few, you know, pinches of salt in a big pond.
I was telling someone that, of course, with all due respect, the Nyoga President Junisha or North Creation is going to have our economy suffer greatly because there's going to be a lot of small businesses that are just surviving. And yet I feel like we should have moved away from that, looking at seeing business thrive, not survive. Because if you tell me you're giving me 3 million, which business idea should I have that is going to thrive? It's going to be for just sustainability, having small businesses
of course
surviving, you know?
Yeah, and that's
not building empires.
That's a discussion we've always been having in some of our researches, where the investment of government towards some of these small entities, it's more of promoting the subsistence sector other than commercializing. And one of our models we thought of was, if instead of having these 5 billion shillings invested in smaller groups, you'd rather have bigger groups, give them about, let's say, 500 million, so that by the end of 3 years, they can support other series of groups. And it's a discussion, if you look at the amount of money we've been investing in EMYOGA, youth livelihood funds, Operation Wealth Creation, there is not SAGE, UWEP, the money for the women and all these monies. You know, they are small to the extent that every year people still expect. So instead of giving someone...
Because they are surviving,
they are
not
surviving,
thriving.
Yes. So we think there should be deliberate efforts, deliberate moves by government, you know, to invest strategically in areas that are meaningful.
All right. There are three notions that I want you to at least advise government. I understand these are proposals that have already been tabled and we hope that they are looked into. Mm. But as we wind up this conversation, there are three notions. There is one of bending so much and doing everything that we can to facilitate the DRM.
Mm.
And number two, the realizing that we're already operating in budget deficits. And number three, being the factor of the times that we're living in, babying an economy that is suffering greatly. So with all these factors considered, the proposals, whether taken into consideration or not, these bills, whether passed or not, where should the discussion bend so much? I mean, there's the three notions that I've given you.
One, I think as a country, we are losing out on our priorities. And sometimes we do the talk, but we don't walk the talk. And that's a reality. If you look at Uganda and they ask government, what are our major export earners? They'll tell you, agriculture. Then following closely, I think currently we have mining, that's gold. Then tourism, right?
Mm-hmm.
Those are the three. So basing on those, if you're to assess the level of investment that the country has put into those sectors, how much are we putting into our tourism budget annually? That's about between 200 and 400 billion Ugandan shillings. And that's peanuts, right? Then how much are we putting in agriculture sector? That's about between 800 billion to 1 trillion. 800 billion to 1 trillion.